Welcome to Penn State Berks and the Berks Launchbox here on the first floor of the GoggleWorks in downtown Reading. I am Melissa Edwards, the Associate Director of Development for the Penn State Berks campus. And I'm here with both Walt Fullum, Director of Outreach and Continuing Education at Penn State Berks, and Paul Esqueda, Interim Division Head of Engineering, Business and Computing, also at Penn State Berks. We're going to talk about innovation, engineering, and economic development in Berks County and what Penn State Berks is doing in that space. These are very important times for Penn State Berks as we celebrate Engineers Week, the week of February 17th, the one-year anniversary of the Berks Launchbox at the GoggleWorks, and the long tradition of engineering at Penn State Berks. Let's begin with Paul. Paul, what is the connection between innovation, engineering, and economic development in Berks County, and what does it mean for Penn State Berks?
Well, let me just say that, first of all, it means a lot. Penn State Berks is embedded in the community, and the success of the Reading community is our success. So, that's important. That's how important it is to Penn State Berks. Now, regarding innovation is defined as the creation of novel ideas that will bring about new products, new processes, and of course, if an educated way to do innovation is to use engineering. And I don't know if you recall, but Penn State University, when it was founded, the charter was to apply scientific knowledge to farming. This is way back in 1850. So our idea, and this is not new, everyone is doing it, is to apply engineering science or apply science to innovation. And that combination of innovation and engineering should bring about economic development. This has been proven in other places in the US and in the world for that matter. So, definitely the creation of new knowledge, new ideas, and with a good entrepreneurship component should bring a economic development. And this is true for Reading, this is true for any city in America.
I'm gonna move over here to Walt. Well, can you tell us a little bit about where we are right now, the Berks Launchbox, and also the Invent Penn State initiative from the university?
Sure, I'd be happy to. So the Invent Penn State initiative was created by President Eric Barron shortly after he arrived at Penn State. And one of the things that is really notable about President Barron is that he has really recommitted the university to its land grant mission. Penn State is one of the 50 land grant universities in the country. We are the land grant university for the state of Pennsylvania. And as such, we have an additional component to our mission, building what Paul was saying. It started with providing education to farmers, but then it broadened to the full range of industrial and business and community organizations across the state. So one of the things in economic development right now is that, you know, years ago there was this concept of smokestack chasing, where communities were looking to bring in big industries, whether they were from another part of the country or from another country. And while that continues to happen, really the focus is on communities themselves developing their own new industries that are really going to power their local economy. And that's what really Invent Penn State is focused on, is helping to leverage the university's resources in the communities across the state to make economic development happen. There's the campuses across the state, each one of them have an Invent Penn State launch box. Ours is the Berks launch box here. Each of those is really focused on the unique needs of that community. And our community here is, there is entrepreneurship that's going on, but there's not a lot that's in the technical area, not a lot that's innovation driven, which is unfortunate because that's really the history of this community. If you look at some of the businesses that started 100 years ago, 50 years ago, whatever, but it's really taking advantage of these new technologies that are out there, like 3D printing. We have these 3D printers behind us, and helping people understand what the application is there. So we're trying to drive economic development, creating an entrepreneurial ecosystem here where we bring people together, people from the community with students, with faculty, learn new ideas, apply new ideas, work with other, collaborate with other entrepreneurs. And Since we have moved to the GoggleWorks here, we have seen the numbers of people that are interested really increase. The GoggleWorks is just an absolutely fantastic place because there's a lot of creative energy here, a lot of artistic people, a lot of innovative ideas, and so we're able to really capitalize on that in addition to the technical knowledge that Paul had talked about to really lead to some good things. We're working with upwards right now of over 20 companies that are really innovation-driven companies. A lot of them are student-based, and some are run by graduates. Others are community folks. So it's very exciting time to be involved in this and what we're doing. And we love being at the GoggleWorks. You know, we talked about the topic is here is economic development. And just to reinforce that, what we're really trying to do with the Launchbox is help create a more vibrant economic future for the city of Reading and environs. And so what we're really looking to do is to help create companies that are going to move into these new spaces in downtown that people like Alan Schumann and John Weidenhammer are creating. And so how do we do that? Well, we provide opportunities for people to come in and attend these programs I've been talking about. And then as they develop their ideas, we have something called a co-working space, where right now we have 5 companies. It's free space that they can come in. They get access to a lot of services that we can provide. Again, it's an innovative environment where they can share ideas with other people. And then they can continue to work and use some of the equipment that's here. And so we kind of feed people in here through the makerspace and through the programs we offer. Not all of those people are going to develop ideas, but right. Some of them that do go into the co-working space will stay with us for about a year or so, and then hopefully we can launch them out into the community. Now, one of the things, again, connecting to engineering and economic development and innovation is some people are going to have needs to develop their ideas for prototyping, per se, that go beyond what they can do or we can offer here. But we have a fantastic resource for them that Dr. Esqueda will talk about, which is the Learning Factory, the Berks Learning Factory, where they can work with faculty and students over there. So, Paul, you want to talk a little bit about the Learning Factory?
Thank you. Well, the Learning Factory, the Berks Learning Factory, is an initiative where students in the first year, particularly in Engineering Design 100, undertake projects that are brought in by industry, local industry. So, you know, a company in the area needs a specific design, and the way it is done is that we set up teams of about 3 or 4 students, and all the students in a class of about 24 are given the same project, and then the teams will come with different ideas to solve the problem or come up with a design. So these introduce a variety to the customer, which is the company, and also gives the students the possibility to work in real life problems. This same idea is used in capstone projects in the Electromechanical Engineering Technology program and in the Mechanical Engineering program, where students in the senior year are given a project that is brought in by a company, local company, local manufacturer, and then they develop the solution to whatever idea there is, and then they do a design in one semester, and then they build what they've designed the following semester. So it is a one-year project, and again, like Walt Fullum mentioned before, it's been a very successful experience.
The history of Penn State Berks goes back to perhaps, shall I say, 1929, when the textile industry in Reading created the Wyomissing Polytechnic Institute, which was a kind of a hands-on apprenticeship German model of education, where students were trained on the job and at the same time were provided with education in engineering, by the way. So the facilities of Wyomissing Polytechnic Institute were transferred to Penn State University in what was called the Penn State Center back then. This is in 1958. Since 1958, Penn State Berks has been operating in Berks County. And the first degrees that were created back then were associate degrees in engineering, in mechanical engineering and electrical engineering. In 1996, Penn State launched the Electromechanical Engineering Technology Program, which has been running since then, since 1996, and that is a NABET accredited program. the Accreditation Board for Engineering Technology, and that program has been very successful in placing our graduates in all the companies in the county, particularly companies like East Penn Manufacturing, Enersys, and Carpenter Technology. So that's a long tradition there. Then most recently, about 5 years ago, we launched the mechanical engineering degree that right now has about 100 students in between senior, into juniors and seniors. And so the strength of the college is resides on one, a strong student body, accreditation of both programs, mechanical engineering and electromechanical engineering technology. The faculty, we have 21 full-time faculty members in the program. 15 of those have PhD degrees, and they are very active in research. And I need to point out the facilities. We have the all the electrical engineering labs that support the EMET program, and also a mechanical engineering lab that supports the mechanical engineering program. But specifically, I would mention the prototype lab, where students can build practically anything they design in our facilities. So the facilities are really state of the art. One of the recent additions to the engineering programs is the flow discovery lab, which is a kind of a wind tunnel type of facility to see the response of objects when they're subjected to a flow of water. In the case of wind tunnels, it's air, but in the case of the flow visualization lab, it is a flow, a liquid that flows and sees how different shapes react to this. And this has been applied to various areas. One of them is, for example, blood flow in the veins or arteries, where there might, usually there are objects that can block the flow. Thank you.
Awesome.
Can I add something here?
Sure.
Yeah, just to build on what Paul was talking about there, and an earlier comment where he said we're really embedded in the community. We've had a history of responding to community needs, and in 1985 we actually brought the Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering on an extended basis from University Park at the request of, at the time, AT&T Technologies, and probably had well over 100 of their employees go through that program. Just after that, then we worked with Penn State Harrisburg to bring in the Bachelor of Science in Electrical Engineering Technology for students who had graduated with a two-year engineering technology degree in other businesses that weren't as concerned about having a BSEE. The BSEET was fine. Then we worked with Penn State Harrisburg to bring in the BS in Mechanical Engineering Technology, folks who had the two-year Mechanical Engineering Technology degree, and then out of that led to the creation of the BSMET program, which continues to be able to serve adult students. Classes are available at night, and we have a good proportion of those students who are currently working in industry and extending and expanding their education by enrolling in that program at night. So
that's great. You can hold on to that, I think.
Right.
Yeah. So as we kind of bring together the history of engineering and where we're at with engineering programming right now, could you tell me a little bit about how we plan to celebrate Engineers Week, both of you, the week of February 17th on our campus?
Absolutely. I would. That's why I'm here.
All right.
Engineers Week is obviously, it's a national, I think it's probably an international celebration of engineering, the importance of engineering, help people focus on our modern life really depends on the work of engineers to create all these fantastic devices and things we have that really support life as we know it today. And so over the last few years, we have done more and more to kind of, from the campus's standpoint, celebrate Engineers Week. And a lot of it is, in the past, has been student-driven, and it continues to be student-driven and faculty-driven, but we have a couple of new things this year. One in particular is we're inviting alumni, so if we have any alums out there that are watching this, please take note. On Monday, February 17th, from 5:30 to 7:30, we're going to have a reception in the Gage Building. Some of you may have graduated a while ago, may not have even been in the Gage Building yet, so this is your chance to see what the environment and the labs we now have to offer our program. It's called a Celebration of Excellence in Engineering Alumni Presentation. And then also on Monday, as part of that, we have a presentation on Industry 4.0 and the Digital Design and Manufacturing Center, which we're developing, and that will be presented by Professor Terry Spiker, who is leading that effort. So I'll pass it over to Paul to talk about the other exciting things happening.
Wonderful.
Well, on Wednesday of Engineers Week, we're going to have a panel discussion where we're going to have representatives from the local companies to talk to our students about career development, how they envision a career for our new graduates as they enter the job market. Then on Thursday, we will have an open house in Penn State Berks so that the public in general can visit the facilities. We'll have high school students coming over. And then on Friday, we're going to have a competition where our engineering students will design and build a package to protect an egg, and then the egg will be dropped from a certain altitude, and so the winners will be the ones that get the egg to survive the fall. All right?
Good luck to them. All right. So, as we wrap up a little bit here, I'd like to just kind of pose the question to you both on the future of engineering in Berks County and what that looks like for our students at Penn State Berks and in our engineering programs.
Sure. I think the future for Penn State Berks in engineering is great. It just looks excellent. Both the combination of the EMET program, Electromechanical Engineering Technology, and the Mechanical Engineering Technology program, they both combine. We have more, almost close to 300 students. So that's huge considering the size of our college. And I think this is going to grow. We are, of course, looking into other programs that we could take, like computer engineering. Electrical engineering is an option. But by the way, we have an invited talk during Engineers Week on Thursday at 6 p.m. We've invited Professor Bob Cabley to talk from Villanova University to talk about the future of electrical engineering. So the future is bright. It's perhaps and it's always been that way. So I think we're going to grow and be strong.
That's awesome. Walt, did you want to talk a little bit more about the future of the Launchbox and what you're seeing there?
Sure, but we're getting someone from Villanova coming to talk. I thought they were just a basketball school. They actually have. It's a joke because that's what people say about Penn State. We're just a football school, which of course we're more than that. Although we're very well known for football, and Villanova is very well known for basketball. One of the things that's interesting is when you think of our topic today with innovation and engineering and economic development. Historically, you have the idea of the lone scientist in a lab someplace. It might be Thomas Edison or someone like that that's toiling away to come up with these new ideas. And innovation and the development of innovation has really changed pretty dramatically, and it's become much more of a collaborative undertaking. And so that's one of the things that we're really trying to model here in and provide the opportunity and an environment where people with different talents and different ideas can come together, because that's really what it takes now. So as an example, I mentioned that we have these 20 plus, close to 25 companies we're working with. A number of those have originated in a program we have on campus called PAYDEP, which it's an acronym and I can't tell you exactly what it means. But the purpose of PAYDEP, it was started a number of years ago, and it really gets at, I think it's a really good example of how innovation occurs today. We had a faculty member in electrical engineering who's now since retired, but he had a special needs daughter. And he was very aware that there were things that were not available that could make her life easier that people weren't developing, because people weren't thinking of someone with a disability as a potential market for products that could help make their life easier.
Sure.
So he came up with the idea of engineering to working with a faculty member in occupational therapy to collaboratively work on ideas. And so over the years, they came up with a lot of great ideas over a one semester project. But they never went anywhere after that. You know, people got excited about it, but then the students all moved on. So what was missing was the opportunity to have, to bring in an entrepreneurial development. Like, this isn't just an idea that you came up with. This is something you could turn into a product. So we now take those students, they might be 10 different projects that they're working on. We pick the top three, and then those students go over into a business class in our entrepreneurship minor. And then they collaborate with business students who become consultants to help them develop the business plan for what they might, you know, how they might price the product, what the potential markets are, really dive in more deeply. And then we don't stop there. We also have them work with students in our writing program that has an emphasis on social media and marketing. And they come up with materials to help them sell it, whether it's a brochure, videos. And then some of those companies, they get to the point where they incorporate, they file all their paperwork, and now they're working with us to actually bring those ideas, which are then become products, are now developing into companies. And so that's just one example, and we're trying to kind of really recreate and expand that with people from the community as well, because collaboration is really the key. And there, what I just talked about was you have the engineering talent, but the occupational therapy students then bring in the application. And it's kind of interesting to see those students work together, because engineers sometimes tend to think, well, they have the answer. They have this idea, and that's all that's needed. But again, a product is not just an idea. It's not just technology. It's application. And then the business students bring in, okay, it's a great idea, but you got to be able to produce it in a quantity that you can sell enough that you can make this economically viable. And then the communications and marketing students help them tell the story.
Sure.
Of how do you do this. So it's a great idea. We're really pleased with how that's working out, and we think it's a good model for how we can work with other kinds of students as well as people from the community.
Great. Awesome.
I'm not sure, did I answer your question, or did I just...
I mean, of course.
Do we have a little time left?
Probably
okay.
A little bit of time.
We got a little time. Okay.
Can you talk about some of the community programming too?
Yeah, Paul's eager for the microphone, but I got it. I'm not giving it back.
All right. We'll get you.
Yeah, Melissa will help you out there. No, so it's a good point, Melissa, when you're saying, well, how do we make that work here? So we have a variety of programs, and one of the things that we're really trying to teach people is design thinking, creative problem solving. You have an idea, there's the whole, you know, develop the business idea, you know, develop your business case, do your financials. But if you don't have a really good product that's really going to meet people's needs, the rest of those things are kind of exercises in futility.
Sure.
So we have classes that if we can help people learn about tools that can help them develop their ideas. So learn about 3D printing. That's been a really successful class we've been offering. It's filled up every time we've offered it. We're getting more equipment, which I should mention now. We have a laser cutter that people can use to develop things. We've got some other pieces of equipment that are going to be coming in that I won't really get into at this point. But in addition to classes like 3D printing, we have some workshops. In fact, we had just one the other night. We had about a dozen people at was Introduction to a Makerspace. And we had a really diverse number of people that came in here, some with a lot of knowledge, engineers who want to learn how to apply it, and others were, you know, people who just had ideas, just people from the community, who had ideas to do something that was completely different from their job. So, without going into a whole list of things, one of the things I will say that we have is we're just trying to get people coming here and meeting and interacting. So we have something called meetups, which we have usually about three or four during the course of the fall or spring. The next one we have coming up is on March 4th, and I think it's one that would be of interest to a lot of people, is entrepreneurship as a second career. Because we all tend to think of Bill Gates or Steve Jobs or people like that, you know, these wet behind the ears people with these fantastic ideas for technology. And that's an important part of technology. But the average age of a successful entrepreneur when they start is 40, and the average age of the leader of a growing startup company is about 45. So we've got a couple of interesting people. We got someone who was in sales for many years, very successful sales career, and then started his own archery target company. We have another person that was in computer science field, now raises fish, tilapia. And then we have another one with a person who is, still has a day job, but is has an expanding job on the side, making tea, meadow tea. And they're all right in this area doing some interesting things. So if you want to learn more about it, visit the BerksLaunchbox.com website and come and find out what we're all about on March 4th.
Wonderful. Back to you, sir.
Oh, thank you. I just wanted to add that, you know, in addition to the engineering programs that we have, that also we have other programs that contribute to innovation and, of course, to economic development. One of the programs is the Information Sciences and Technology program, which is a four-year baccalaureate degree. The other program is the Security and Risk Analysis program, which is, again, another four-year baccalaureate degree. And then we have another degree in Cybersecurity Operations and Analytics, which is perhaps a topic that has a lot of innovations. And one of the companies that we are providing support to in the launch box is a company in cybersecurity, which is a critical topic today as networks expand into wireless networks, cloud connected, et cetera, et cetera.
Wonderful. Great. Okay. Well, gentlemen, I think that's it for today. And to find out more about Engineers Week or other initiatives at Penn State Berks as it pertains to innovation or economic development, you can visit our website at berks.psu.edu. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.